It's my honor actually to tell you a little bit about Mary Gao. She's my esteemed colleague. We've worked together for 25 years. She is the publications coordinator of the UCLA Asian American Studies Center. And she is also the artistic vision and spirit behind all the publications that have come out of there for the past 25 years. She actually has actually taught women's studies at UCLA and also edited a special issue of AmerAsia Journal on women. But we have 10 copies actually available at a special discount price, The Movement and the Moment, that Mary designed and worked with Glenn Uyematsu and Steve Louis. And it's a compilation of stuff from the 60s and has a rare archival photos and other materials in it. And Mary would be available after the talk to sign the books. Well, I was trying to pitch books. You know, California economy and UC system is in a very bad state. And as I said, when people look at books from the UCLA Asian American Studies Center, most people don't read them. They just say, they look great. And then they don't read them. So basically, it's how it looks. It's very important. And most people divorce image from ideology. But actually, image and ideology are quite closely related, and the editorial. But I don't want to talk too much because we have Mary here. And besides taking you back in time, she's going to basically, I think, review how the lessons of the 60s are actually appropriate to now. What's happening today, because all the things that were happening in the 60s, in many cases, not only the residue, but, like the prison industrial complex, the military industrial, it's still around, healthier than ever. So Mary also received her, besides her BA from UCLA, she received her MA in Asian American Studies a couple of years ago. And right now, I'd like to welcome my colleague, Mary Uyematsu Kao. Mary.
Thank you all for coming. This is really kind of a treat for me to be able to come and share my pictures with you and also to share some of the oral history work that I did on actually Japanese American third generation women, Sansei women that were in the movement in the early 1970s. But I would like to start off with the slideshow and kind of get everybody in the mood. So all these photographs are photographs that I took in the early 70s. At the time, I was actually in a graduate film program at UCLA. The program was called Ethnocommunications. It was a minority filmmaking program. And I didn't finish, but I was taking a lot of pictures of the Asian American movement at the time. So most of these are from that period.
Come all this way.
after about 20 years working at Asian American Studies at UCLA, basically I would, you know, do the journals, Amerindian Journal, Russell has been my boss all that time. So we've gotten to know each other very well. But after 20 years, my kids were grown and, you know, it was time for me to spend a little on myself. And so I went back for the MA program in Asian American Studies. And going into the MA program, you know, it took me 20 years partly because I, one, never saw myself as an academic. And I actually wasn't that crazy about a lot of the academics. You know, and I was, you know, publications coordinator is actually a very glorified term for ship worker, you know, which is what I did a lot of. You know. But anyway, going back into the MA program was a very interesting experience because the Asian American Studies was started by the movement, you know, in the 60s. And it's you know, become very institutionalized, and today we have professors who are teaching Asian American Studies classes who probably know very, very little about the Asian American movement, which pretty much gave birth to their jobs, right? So it's kind of an unfortunate situation. There seems to be kind of a gap between Asian American history before the 60s movement and then after the 60s movement, but that period of the movement has not really been covered. And our generation is here, right? And we need to do something. You know, we need to document what we went through, because I don't know how many people have written read William Wade's book on the Asian American movement, but I think for most of us that went through the movement, we do not want to see that as the last word on what the movement was, because he's got his own special twist on it. And I know most movement people that have read the book that, you know, experience the movement, they're like really, really unhappy with it, you know. So some of that is our fault. We have to do something about it, right? And, you know, I mean, at our age, you know, we're all mostly in our 60s now. It's like, you know, we're not too motivated to be out there demonstrating or, you know, I mean, you know, our activism has gone through changes. And so, you know, what are some of the things that we can do, you know, today? So a lot of my comments are actually going to be focused towards my generation of people that went through the Asian American movement, so I hope you don't mind. Now, one of the reasons that I feel it's important for this generation to document the history is because more and more Asian American studies is getting removed from, you know, what's happening in Asian American and Pacific Islander communities. And that has actually been the heart of Asian American Studies. That's why we formed, right? And that really gives the basis for what kind of research we should be doing. We should be getting actively involved and getting students involved in community struggles. And, you know, this is the process of change, which has been really important and given life to Asian American Studies. So hopefully this talk will, you know, address that. Also, knowing our activist history is knowing how Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders have created change in this country. If we don't know it, then, you know, we figure, well, you know, we're fine, right? We're fine just the way we are, right? And a lot of times we're not, you know, things happen. So, for instance, you know, as far as how well people know what happened back then, for Japanese, also my comments will be focused mostly on Japanese Americans, which is kind of ironic because I have not really represented Japanese Americans in a lot of my work for quite a long time. So I've kind of come full circle. But I guess being married to a Chinese immigrant, I have learned more about myself as a Japanese American, and I guess I've kind of found my identity through that experience. One of the things that Japanese Americans first did in the very early days of the Asian American movement, and this was a group of people who's probably a little bit older than my age group. They're probably in their early 70s now. But they worked on the repeal of the Title II of the Internal Security Act. Now, the Internal Security Act, which was in 1950, was part of the whole era of McCarthyism. Okay, and this is pretty much the era, the Cold War, that most of us grew up under. And it's kind of, you know, looking back, it's kind of hard to realize, you know, what were the historical conditions we were actually, you know, growing up under. We don't really think about it. You know, we just think about, well, this happened and that happened, but you don't really think of it in terms of what was the historical period at that time. So this this small group of Japanese Americans in Oakland, who was very progressive, and they wanted to fight against this Title II Act, they did it. This is a quote from Ray Okamura. "This small East Bay group realized that Japanese Americans, as past victims of American concentration camps, were in the best position to lead a repeal campaign. Moreover, the group felt it was imperative for Japanese Americans to assume leadership in order to promote third world unity. Japanese Americans had been the passive beneficiaries of the Black Civil Rights Movement." And I bring this up because a lot of people that learn about Asian American, the Asian American movement, or Asian American studies, do not necessarily see any tie with the Black Civil Rights Movement or the Black Power Movement. And it's very important to understand the link that we had, and that at the time, you know, most of us took the leadership of the Black Liberation Movement as our leadership and saw their struggle as our struggle. And, you know, who knows what people know these days, you know, what they're learning. And so these are things that I feel are very important to remind people of, and this is also where I think people who went through that experience will have that perspective and will be able to pass that on. Whereas people who are learning it, basically through what's been written, may not get that. Okay, the problem is there has not been a whole lot written. And there's been even less written on Asian American women from that movement. And so this is where I focus my thesis work for my master's, Asian American Studies. One of the things that I found, which I was pretty disturbed at, was I read, you know, some stuff from Asian American feminists from the 80s, 90s, and they were saying how Asian American women in the movement were, you know, these victims of male chauvinism, and it made us seem like we were helpless, you know, and it was just like, you know, that's horrible, right? You know, I mean, I don't want to be remembered as this victim, right? You know, and so a lot of that is because there has not been that much written. And then the few things that have been written, one of the biggest pieces that has been written is by Susie Ling called Mountain Movers. And what she did was she established that there was male chauvinism in the Asian American movement. And I think that was probably at the time kind of a surprise for people, because they thought, well, the movement, everybody's great, and, you know, this and that. And so I was like, oh, shit, you know, there's male chauvinism in the movement, right? You know. But, you know, I think most people know that now. But the question is, how did that affect women? You know, were we helpless victims, or did we struggle with it? And we did. We struggled with it, right? And it made us stronger, and it, you know, by staying within the Asian American movement, I think it helped, we helped change things. We helped change our community, as opposed to, like, say, getting into the women's movement, which was not really addressing racism at the time, and mainly looking at things in terms of women. And, you know, a lot of it was seeing men as the enemy, right? And we still had a lot of struggles as Asian Americans. And so we kept our movement with, you know, our women's issues within the Asian American movement and took the struggle from there. So I kind of understood why these later day feminists saw the Asian American women move, Asian American women activists as these victims of male chauvinism, because there wasn't anything discussing what we were doing, right? They didn't discuss how we were leaders, which we were. There were plenty of women leaders, right? And it was also maybe looking at leadership in certain very, you know, established ways of, you know, well, men do this and men do that. But, you know, women were doing all kinds of things, right? And so it kind of led to this, mischaracterization of, you know, what we were doing at the time. And, you know, that's where I wanted to really delve into how women were transformed, you know, by getting involved in the movement and doing a lot of things that we never would have done before. Also, to take it back to looking at where we were at before the movement happened. Okay, so that's the thing about looking at the Cold War, conditions of the Cold War, and how we were raised. And then once the movement happened, how that, you know, led to our transformation. And I also focus on Japanese Americans because I do not presume that each nationality that was in the Asian American movement, at the time it's predominantly Chinese, Japanese, Filipino. There were very few Koreans, you know, and those were the basic groups of the Asian American movement at the time. Japanese Americans, I feel, were much more the kind of the epitome of the model minority. Chinese Americans, they were somewhat suspect because of socialist China, you know, so they were not as much into the model minority as I think Japanese Americans were. And the Filipinos were, you know, fall more into this colonized subject. So these are very rough characterizations. Anyways, because of that, I feel like...
Sorry.
Thank you. That's my husband. because of that, I wanted to focus on a particular nationality to follow them through and see, you know, because I don't think it applies the same to each nationality. So the Cold War, the very first thing that we start off with is basically Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The U.S. bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki kicks off the Cold War. Basically, 2 million people in Japan were obliterated. And it was not really to end the war with Japan, because the war was over. Okay, it was to show the Soviet Union that we had the weapons of mass destruction, right? And we were willing to use them. When I say we, I'm talking about the U.S. government, right? And so this is the big kickoff of the Cold War, right? And then at home, domestically, is McCarthyism. They need to turn around, you know, a lot of the militant struggles of people in this country that was happening in the 30s and the 40s. And also, during the war, a lot of women and a lot of minorities were able to get jobs in a lot of industries to help the war effort. And they basically had to shove all those people back out because, you know, the guys were coming home and they wanted to give them the jobs, right? And so there's all these different things happening. McCarthyism was trying to show in its own weird way that democracy was much better than totalitarianism in the Soviet Union. We also at that time had the birth, basically the birth of mass media, television, right? And for the first time in the US, everyone's watching pretty much the same shows. You know, it's not like today, right? I mean, today everybody could have all these choices, but there weren't the kind of choices that there were. And so in a lot of ways, television had a huge effect, you know, and it was a great way to kind of feed out, you know, whatever they wanted people to really be into. Okay, the Cold War also, because of this, because of the McCarthyism, you know, this trying to show that, you know, we're such a great democracy versus the Soviet Union, we have the civil rights movement, right? Because African Americans are saying, hey, you know, what about us? We still don't have our equal rights, right? And so that's where the mass media comes in. We were all watching it on television. You know, we're watching what was happening in the South. We're watching people who are protesting, getting fire hosed down, getting attacked by dogs, right? And so this, you know, I mean, I remember those images, and it I'm sure it had a tremendous effect on everybody, and especially for people of color. They could really identify with that because they didn't feel like, well, they did. They didn't have the equal rights either. So the Cold War, you know, it's this whole historical period which a lot happened. For Japanese Americans, which basically from end of the war, 1945 to 1965, 20-year span, Japanese Americans go from being the enemy to mono minority. That's a big change, right? And how does that happen, you know? Well, one big reason is, you know, the U.S. needed Japan as a strategic ally in Asia. You know, there was the whole containment policy of the Soviet Union in China, okay? And Japan, because of the use of the bomb, was basically, you know, we were a subject of the U.S., right? We were basically their toy at that time. And, you know, it's continued. And so Japanese Americans, and then, you know, they also did a number on us here, sending us to concentration camps so that once they started promoting us as a model minority, a lot of people were kind of like, oh, yeah, you know, we're accepted now. And a lot of others, and I guess our generation realized that, you know, because we're all watching the civil rights movement and then the Black Power movement starting to come into being. We are being used against the blacks, right? They are promoting us and telling blacks, why don't you be like them, right? Here's these nice model minorities who went to concentration camp during World War II. They came out and now they're working hard and they're not raising any fuss and, you know, why don't you be like them, right? And so for a lot of young people, they realize that, you know, hey, you know, we're not any better than black people as far as what we have, you know, and this is basically a sham. They're using us. And so this, and you know, I mean, the thing is the model minority myth still lasts to today, right? And there's still like this pull that, you know, Asian Americans, well, you could be like honorary white people, right? You know, people are always going through the struggle, right? So where do we stand? For women, The women all basically, you know, from the after the war, had to basically go back to the home front, right? They didn't want us in the factories anymore. And so, you know, they had to do all kinds of stuff to try and get women to be domesticated again. The worst, you know, some of the worst things that happened is they were actually giving electric shock treatments to women, you know, to help them become domesticated. I think one of the most famous cases is, I forgot her last name, the movie is Frances. Have people seen it? With Jessica Lange? And, you know, she was a very progressive woman, right? She was an actress, beautiful actress, and because of her ideas, right, her progressive ideas, they said, you know, this is not right, and they were giving her electric shock treatments, right? The reason I bring this up is because also one of my interviewees, her mother was also getting electric shock treatments, you know, so it's not like it was that obscure. It was happening to people, right? And this was a Nisei woman. For Sansei girls growing up, during this period, education, well, I interviewed 7 people, so I can't say I've got this, you know, this fantastic proof that I talked to everybody and this is what happened, right? But I interviewed basically 6-7 people, and out of the 7, each one represented a different Japanese enclave in Southern California, which is, you know, at least kind of a sampling of people. And all of them said, you know, my parents didn't really care if I went to college. You know, it was like, the main reason they wanted me to go to college was to meet a guy who, you know, was going to be a professional or, you know, college-educated guy. And that's where to find a good husband. And so this was, you know, the stuff that we were raised on, right? One woman's mother, she actually discouraged her from taking advanced placement classes because she didn't want her daughter to be too smart, and she wanted her really to go to business school because she knew that she could get jobs as a secretary. And so this reflects the experience of second generation Nisei Japanese American women, is that, you know, people were college graduates, they couldn't get jobs, except in the produce market, clerical, secretarial jobs, you know. So in a lot of ways, the education didn't matter either, right? Because you couldn't do anything with it. Another woman, her brother's education was more important than hers, so basically she had to drop out of college because the family couldn't afford to send both of them to college, right? So she was willing to, you know, give up her college for her brother because that was seen as more important. Also, whether it was your mother or your grandmother, they were always telling you, don't get too smart because the guys don't want to marry you, right? So, you know, all those are always, you know, this is how we were raised. You know, these were always being drummed into us. I don't know how much of this is because particular Japanese, or if this was something that, you know, as U.S. mainstream was actually just pushing out to women also. And another woman, she was, you know, her family discouraged her from going to grad school, but it was actually a guy from the movement, a sansei, who really encouraged her to go on to grad school. So while there was male chauvinism in the movement, you know, there were guys were not all bad, you know. Let's see. So, how's my time? Huh? Another hour. No, I'm not going to talk another hour. I'm winding down. Okay, so how the movement changed Sansei women. Well, I would say first, gender relations in the Japanese American community and probably most immigrant communities, I think, change once people get here. You know, I think the fight for survival, you can't, to be practical, you can't hold on to a lot of the traditional stuff. You know, depending on your economic status, some people that are rich enough might be able to hold on to certain traditional things more than others, but I would contend that gender relations, you know, pretty much has changed as soon as we get here. One of the, I know, like my grandmother, and I think it applied to a lot of other women coming from Japan, she was a divorcee. And this is something I didn't find out until way, way, way later, you know, that this was her second marriage, right? But there were a lot of divorcees who wouldn't be able to have a very good life in Japan, and so they came here, right? And so, you know, that already kind of sets the stage for different gender relations here. Also, during the World War II concentration camps, Nisei women, a lot of them were sent to colleges in all-white communities, and so, you know, they got experiences that really probably changed their lives too, you know, pushed them, you know, out beyond the Japanese American community and experience. So of the women that I interviewed, I will just give a few samples of how they feel like the movement changed their lives. The movement helped me stand up for myself as a woman. I'm sure it was part of the reason why I got out of a bad marriage. And I think that if I hadn't experienced the movement, then I would still be in that box of marriage, kids, you stick it out no matter what. That is from Carol. And then from Vivian, we have, you can only, okay, now this is something that I can, at 61 years old, I can kind of appreciate. I think if I was younger, I may not have liked to have heard this. So for the young women here, you may not want to hear this. But anyway, you can only go as far as your history takes you. In other words, you have certain limitations. And no matter what you do, you can't leap into the 22nd century. You just have to move a little farther ahead so that someone else in back of you can move ahead farther. And the last quote I'd like to read is from a woman named Wendy. And she sums up, I think, the transformation from before to the movement really well. I know for Carol and myself, we were really caught up in going to parties. Our hair had to be so big, and we would spend all Saturday at her sister's house, and we would be ratting our hair and putting it into curls and spend hours on our makeup, trying to make our eyes look bigger, the dressing the right way, and then in the movement, we wore no makeup. We probably looked horrible, but we didn't care. We wore our hair straight and looking really dowdy, but we didn't care. We were saving the world. So I think I will end there, and I would really like to kind of have a conversation with the audience, you know, and people, especially my comrades here, you know, share their experiences. And, you know, it's open for whatever. Quirky.
There are a lot of Japanese Americans that refer to these internment camp period as internment camps.
Yes.
But the activist Japanese refer to them as concentration camps, okay? And that's something I don't think is actually discussed in Asian American history classes, the difference between, because I think the students think that internment camp is synonymous with concentration camp. So would you want to offer an explanation for that? The difference between
I think internment is just cleaned up version of concentration camp. Concentration camp, you think of Germany, right? And of course, the U.S. does not want to, you know, have any, you know, we don't do those things, right? But, you know, I think for Japanese activists especially, they want to, like, you know, call a spade, and it's like, hey, you know, it was a concentration camp. They were forced there. So internment camp sounds nicer. I don't know, other people could share.
Well, I think internment was used as the, for, what's the order number
9066.
Yeah, so that was the description. They didn't just call, let's go to camp.
Yeah, but, although like our parents, they all referred to it as camp, right? And up until the movement, my parents always talked about, well, especially my mother, about the great time she had in camp. And this was also pretty common among the women I interviewed, is that they thought camp was like summer camp or something, right? Until they started taking Asian American Studies classes and finding out that it was an internment or a concentration camp, right? And so I used to argue with my parents, like, you know, how could you say you had fun? You know, you were put there, you know, and, you know, you were sent there by force, right?
Well, one of the reasons, I think, was because, I mean, Japanese Americans were, in the 50s, I mean, when I grew up out west, for Chinese American, we were like 10 blocks from the, 20, a mile away from another family. And to get together was like, oh, if you're going to Chinese school, you see a lot of Chinese faces.
Right.
The same with gathering, you know, celebration.
Yes.
Mostly Japanese American were on the farm.
Right.
And they had to work 9/6 to 6, you know, whatever hours.
Right.
To maintain the farm and stuff. And then property. I mean, the whole problem now is ownership of property. You know, how many minorities have that privilege? Properties were taken from the farmers. And
right.
I understand that while Japanese American had farms, they would hire the Mexicans to do the work. So there was a lot of that interaction going on.
Right.
And World War II, the other things happening in Mexico, Asian. But anyway, I would call it the underground dynamics of how a minority can survive in a mainstream society.
Come here.
I think Corky's observation is interesting because it seems to have a lot to do with the difference between how the East Coast views the movement and the West Coast views the movement. When the Japanese American Museum brought an exhibit to Ellis Island and they used concentration camps in the title, the Jewish community here in New York is offended. And I think that it raised some very interesting discussions. I mean, it created a space in which to have a dialogue between the two groups. But I think because of the population here and the community here and how different I think the experiences were, there was a real need to engage in that dialogue. Whereas I think on the West Coast, it may not have seemed like such. It might have just seemed like a sort of semantic or a language issue. So I just feel like, I was just wondering like whether you, I know you concentrated in California, on Japanese Americans in California, whether you have any observations about the difference between
Yeah, no, I'm glad you brought that up because I really don't know if that's an East Coast, West Coast thing on the concentration, use of the word concentration camp, you know, and I remember hearing about that situation where Japanese American National Museum came out and did that, right? And there was that whole thing. I don't know. You know, if that's really, if it's more commonly used in the West Coast. Because until actually, until really recently, I interchangeably use it, right? And I don't know, I guess I had this whatever that, you know, I'm being too soft by saying internment. So I don't know. The one experience I have noticing the difference between the LA movement versus the New York movement, because that's my direct experience, was that in Los Angeles, if you were a student, a college student, you were not a good movement person. You had to drop out of school, you know, to be down, right? You know, you're not down with the struggle if you don't drop out of school, right? And so I finally left LA, came to New York, and I was telling everybody, I said, hey, I left school, you know, I'm down, right, you know? And then the New York people were like, what's wrong with that, you know? What, you don't have to leave school, you know? So, I mean, that was one difference, but I know there's a lot of differences, you know? Yeah.
I'm wondering whether you could just, because a couple years ago, the UCLA Asian American Studies, and Mary was involved, we published a book with the Museum of Tolerance on the garment work.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then there was, you know, remember they tossed the books and stuff because a lot of the garment workers, the garment factories were owned by Jews.
Right.
Actually, yeah. But I mean, it, in terms of race relations, remember that
incident?
Right.
Well, I'm not sure what to say about it. Well, I mean, yeah, the interesting thing, I guess, with that is it's the museum of, see, now I get confused because I want to say intolerance because they were not being very tolerant. And it had to do with, you know, we published a book on, it's the history of the garment.
Rock and Hard Place.
Yeah, garment sweatshops. Right, and it went from all the way back to, you know, the 1800s up to present, the El Monte Thai workers that were basically being held in pretty much slave-like conditions, right? And because a lot of the stuff on, I think it was mainly one essay in there, which talked about some of the Jewish contractors, you know, who owned these shops, right, that they did not want to have any part of this book, right? The book was accompanying an exhibit by the Smithsonian, you know, on the garment sweatshops, right? The whole history of them. And they basically tossed the book out, you know, they didn't destroy it, but I found them in somebody's art installation. They're just stacked up. I mean, it was weird. It was really weird. Yeah.
So what did the Japanese American Museum do with when that controversy came up?
I think, you know, I mean, because I could understand the difference, you know, there is a difference, and it's, I guess, something that to be sensitive to, and at the same time it's like, you know, do you want to go along with the internment line that, you know, the U.S. was, you know, a lot kinder, which I guess you could say they were, but Corky.
Well, there's actually evidence that Roosevelt referred to the camps as concentration camps, but the Jewish community and conservative elements within the Japanese American community basically turned it to internment camp, okay? But in reality, the concentration camps that the Jews were in the Second World War were really death camps. Mm-hmm. So the concentration camps, as the Jews refer to them, should be labeled death camps.
Right, okay? Right.
And I think that, you know, I mean, in terms of, you know, understanding what happened, right? I mean, this is not to say that, yeah, you know, Japanese Americans didn't die in concentration camps, okay?
Yeah.
But it really should be concentration camps. And if the historical evidence, you know, bears fruit that Roosevelt called them concentration camps, I mean, you know, who's going to go against the president, right? But the present-day concentration camp that I see is Guantanamo Bay.
Yeah, right.
I think that we have to look at it in those terms, you know. So but then, English is tough language.
But then there's this sort of thing like ghettoizing the mentality of like why there's, well, we, I mean, in New York City, we, there's a Chinatown, but there hasn't been a Japanese town. It could have been in Lincoln Center, as I heard it. But, I mean, you know, what I heard was like after the internment camp, a lot of the Japanese American came to New York City to get away from the whole racial problems in the West Coast. And so the settlement was going to be at Lincoln Center. But then there are two, I see there are two Japanese American community which is divided, because when the reparation movement came about, there was the Christian Japanese church and then there was the Buddhist church. So, I mean, you know, that was a split from the concentration camps.
I think that existed even before.
Of losing a culture from mainland Japan, and there was some development. I mean, I've interviewed Minnie Okubo in the 1974, I mean, you know, just so I can exhibit her artwork of the concentration camp at the time, because, you know, who knew New York City? They didn't want to know about it, because once I put that exhibit up at Asian Heritage Week in Lincoln Center, and that was our biggest event, you know, and at the moment we were able to get that. I could give credit for that. But I put up the exhibit there with the photos from visual communication. I mean, that was all our sole source of getting photos like that. And I was watching, you know, locals walking by. I mean, even when I showed a photo, I mean, the artwork of Minnie Okubo's drawings in Chinatown, the kids looked at that. You know, they were interested. But, I mean, I was watching this Anglo woman look at it and just turn. We had 100,000 Japanese Americans interned, was the title. And she just turned away. They all just want to go eat sushi. You know, that was the whole attitude. It was the first Asian Heritage Festival in New York City. So then eventually, I guess, the reparation from the West Coast came to New York. The commission here was saying. So, you know, well,
Other comments, questions, discussion?
Did you receive reparations? Did you receive reparations, and how was it divided out? Church.
Everybody got $20,000.
You mean everybody? Everybody who was a Japanese American at that time.
Everybody who went to camp.
In the concentration camp.
Yeah.
Right, and it was during Bush period who signed the bill at Pearl Harbor. You know, that's supposed to be communication. Pearl Harbor Day.
They got it about, I think it was over 50 years after it happened, yeah. Right? So a lot of the Issei who actually suffered the most were dead. They'd already passed on. Yeah.
You said $20,000 for everybody. Is it per household or per person?
Per person.
There has to be a line. So dead cannot be my hand. So it has to be a direct experience in the camp.
They only could be living, they couldn't be the child of...
No.
So, I mean, by 1987, I mean, things that Japanese Americans had the reparation, but there should have been a movement for the reparation for Chinese American working on the railroad ancestry, but there was a bill passed by Congress prior to 1984, that Chinese American can't claim reparations. So, you know, I'm out.
Was there any movement amongst Japanese people not to accept the reparations? Because I know in the black community, some people would say, we don't want the reparations. We don't want to legitimize the system.
I don't think so. I don't know.
Was there somebody said
yeah?
And what was their position, Jack? How did they articulate
it? They wanted to buy what was taken away from them. Okay.
Yeah.
There were a number of essays. Right. No, most of the essays were refused, basically refused. But the initial Bill Horry, this fellow out of Chicago, had said that there was like 110 violations of civil rights when Japanese Americans were incarcerated. Okay, and he assessed a value of $2,000 for every infraction. So that would have given $220,000 to every Japanese American. Okay, and then that was whittled down to $20,000. But it took a Japanese American lobbyist to convince Ronald Reagan at the time, because during the war, Ronald Reagan was a captain somewhere in California, and he wrote a letter to the editor because there was a Japanese American soldier whose only wish was to be buried in the town cemetery, and the townspeople wouldn't let him be buried there. And Ronald Reagan wrote a letter to the editor and says, listen, this guy gave up his life for his country. You know, the least you could do is let him have his last wish be buried in the town cemetery. So that was brought up. And this is at a time when Ronald Reagan is developing Alzheimer's. Okay, but they showed him the evidence. I think they had a Xerox copy of the letter that went to the editor. And then the administration at that time period was very worried that African Americans were going to ask for reparations. Okay. And if you give it to the Japanese, you can give it to African Americans. The African Americans are going to ask for a ton, lot more. All right. So, the evidence, you know, demonstrated to Reagan that, you know, this is what he had said back in during the Second World War. That and at that point, he said that, listen, I'm going to sign this bill, and that's how that passed.
Wow. Which makes us the model minority.
Well, at that point, yeah. It's funny that you mentioned that because. As a black person in America, we have heard that y'all are the model minority. You know?
For real.
It's not a joke. We hit the head with the Asians are smarter, they're more industrious, and consequently more complacent as a result of that. So you all use the term, which I think is cool, not cool, but in a funny kind of way, the model minority. And you started to say, how did that happen? I have some theories, but I'd like to have you kind of give me, you know, after America drops a bomb and kills 2 million Japanese that they'll want to be model minorities, how does that happen psychologically? I have some theories, but can you give me your...
How does it happen?
That psychological and mental transformation takes place to the extent that you would wave the American flag after we realize that this has happened. You know, we can look at it. And then you say that, and they didn't do it in the war. They just did it to use you as an example to Russia to say, this is what we'll do.
So right.
It was like a sacrifice. I mean, person sacrifice.
I think it's probably messed up a lot of people's heads, you know, of Japanese Americans, you know, of not quite knowing how to reconcile all of it. And you probably find tons of different responses of how people have dealt with that, right? But, you know, there is a particular article that this guy William Peterson came out with in Newsweek, which talked about, you know, Japanese Americans being the model minority, right? But I really feel that, you know, behind that is this whole thing of Japan being such a key piece of the U.S. defense in Asia, right? And also with the struggle with Soviet Union and China, they needed, and then Vietnam, right? Japan was very important in this war with Vietnam. Yeah.
You mentioned that when you first got involved in the movement, you felt you had to leave school to sort of...
But I didn't.
Part of it. But I think that was actually a very common feeling, and it seems like that one, I mean, the movement is kind of a catch-all for a lot of different kinds of activism, but in the 70s, there were a lot of people very invested in Marxist-Leninist theory, ideology, and this politics, this radical left politics, really drove a lot of people to become leaders in their community and activists. And I think that that's the big difference between the 70s and today, when a lot of women are in leadership positions that are, you know, very passionate activists, but are not driven by this sort of this Marxist ideology. And I was just wondering if you had any thoughts about that.
Well, I guess the best understanding that I fell upon recently is basically a title of this book, which is called "The Revolution Will Not Be Funded." Okay, and then see, that really hit the spot, and explaining what's happened to the newer generations, right? Everybody, you know, you can graduate college with a degree, you can get a job with a nonprofit agency helping the community, or you feel like you are, right? And still make $100,000 a year, right? Which to us would have been like, no, you know, that doesn't work, right? You know, but, and there's nothing wrong with it, right? You know, and no, there isn't nothing wrong with it, but at the same time, it's like, it's total co-optation, right? You know, you can graduate and you can get these high-paying jobs and you can feel like you're helping the community, and you are, but that's where this book gets into the whole trap, this whole funding trap. They have got you following all these guidelines to where you're corporatized. You're playing their game. And pretty soon, you lose sight of what you went in there in the first place for, right? And so, I really like that title. Yes?
I was really drawn to this event because of the word photographs in the title, and I was wondering if there were any resources that you knew of where, you know, people can find more images of Asian Americans or as activists and in different movements. Like, I teach elementary school and we do a whole thing on civil rights movement, but my kids in East Harlem think civil rights is just, you know, it was just a black movement. And so it would be awesome as a visual piece to have more people, to have more of those images out there. Like, there's a but there's like a resource, there's 500 years of Chicano history. Uh-huh. Like, correct. We need, like, people, we need something like
we that. Do have a book, Asian Americans, the Movement and the Moment, and there are pictures in there.
Okay.
Corky Lee is a big source. Yeah.
You speak of the lack of written works within the Asian American community as well, you know, as African Americans had a Harlem Renaissance and so much literature in regards to the civil rights movement and race relation topics. So why, you know, I'm not Asian American, however, I would like to understand why was there such a lack of literature that wasn't made during that era?
Well, I think it's got to be made now. Which is what I'm making a pitch for, but I think a lot of it is like, you know, people, after that whole period ended, we had to kind of like catch up getting our lives back to normal, because we spent like, you know, at least 10 years of our lives, you know, being committed to a movement, and then find yourself with kids and, you know, no college degree or whatever, you know, but, you know, you got to start paying the bills, and so, you know, life takes over. And then, I don't know, you know, for any number of reasons, right, there's a lot of people who had bad experiences and don't want to talk about it, you know. And I guess one of the reasons I want people to talk about it is whether it was bad or good. If it was bad, it's a healing experience to talk about it. And if it was good, people need to know about it, right? There's a lot being written by Asian Americans, but it's not about the movement.
Let's give Mary a hand.